morning. Welcome to worship. Thank you. Thank you, Lorraine. It is so good to be back here. It is so good to see all of your faces and just to be here to worship together. A couple of announcements before we get started. I have the sad news that Helmut Nitsch, and that is John Voss's stepfather, is in the hospital at Mayo. He suffered a stroke. So Jill and John are with him. So please keep the family in your prayers. You'll hear these next three things, the family of John's stepfather, and then these other two names you'll hear in the prayers, but they won't be in your bulletin, because we got a note from Frank McGinnis that his brother Bill was in an accident in New Jersey, and Joan and Frank would appreciate our prayers. And we also, Marilyn Flanders would like for us to pray for her friend Jenny Kokel. So if you will remember those people, and I think we've got them all in the prayer. Spoken prayers, not the written prayers today. Other things, don't forget the hunger jar. Be sure to take a look at all those beautiful signs out there with all the things that are needed for Grace in the City Heat Respite Program, for the Foothills Food Bank, and for God's Work Our Hands, September the 11th. So lots of good stuff and good ways to get involved to help care for the people of God's world. Is there anything else that we need to know before we begin worship today? Anything I've overlooked? All right, let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship with our prelude, which is going to be Lincoln. Thank you. Please rise and face the font for a short order of confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love endures forever. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not followed your path, but have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at the table. When met by those in need, we have too often passed by on the other side. Set us again on the path of life. Save us from ourselves and free us to love our neighbors. Amen. Hear the good news. God does not deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are free to love as God loves. Amen.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you sent your Holy Spirit to be the life and light of your church. Open our hearts to the riches of your grace, that we may be ready to receive you wherever you appear. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Today is from Hebrews, the 11th chapter. Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the convictions of things not seen. Indeed, by faith our ancestors received approval. By faith we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that it is seen that what was made from things that are not visible. By faith Abraham obeyed when he was called to set out for a place that he had was to receive as his inheritance, and he set out not knowing where he was going. By faith, he stayed for a time in the land that he had been promised, as in a foreign land, living in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked forward to the city that has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith, he received power of procreation. Even through him, faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one person, and one good is dead, descendants were born, as many as the stars in heaven, and as in the innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. All of these died in faith, without having received the promises. But from a distance, they saw and greeted them. They confessed that they were strangers and foreigners on the earth. For peoples who speak in this way make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of the land that they had left behind, they would have had the opportunity to return. But as it is, desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God. Indeed, he has prepared a city for them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Happy is the nation whose God is the Lord. Happy the people chosen to be God's heritage. God sits firmly enthroned and watches all who dwell on the king is not saved by the size of the army, nor are warriors rescued by their great strength. Truly your eye is upon those who fear you, O Lord, upon those who wait for your steadfast love. Our innermost being waits for you, O Lord, our helper and our shield. Your loving kindness, O Lord, be upon us, even as we place our hope in you.
The Holy Gospel according to Luke, the 12th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, "Do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give alms. Make purses for yourselves that do not wear out, an unfailing treasure in heaven, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Be dressed for action and have your lamps lit. Be like those who are waiting for their master to return from the wedding banquet so that they may open the door for him as soon as he comes and knocks. Blessed are those slaves whom the master finds alert when he comes. Truly, I tell you, he will fasten his belt and have them sit down to eat, and he will come and serve them. If he comes during the middle of the night or near dawn and finds them so, Blessed are those slaves. But know this, if the owner of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. You also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. All right, is it running through your head right now? If I could sing, I would sing it for you, because that tune has been in my mind all week as I studied this text, that little hymn that we sometimes sing that goes with this text. And it's a lovely and familiar verse and tune, and it is a comforting promise. Unfortunately, though, our lectionary leaves out the verses that precede this promise. So we're going to look back at that today. Because you remember last week, we ended with the parable about the rich man who stored up treasure for himself, but he was not rich toward God. Jesus says that. And then Jesus says to his disciples, listen to these words. Believe these words. These are your words. Because Jesus says, don't fuss about what's on the table at mealtimes or if the clothes in your closet are in fashion. There is far more to your inner life than the food you put in your stomach, more to your outer appearance than the clothes you hang on your body. Look at the ravens, free and unfettered, not tied down to a job description, carefree in the care of God. And you count far more. Has anyone by fussing before the mirror ever gotten taller by so much as an inch? If fussing can't even do that, why fuss at all? Walk into the fields and look at the wildflowers. They don't fuss with their appearance, but have you ever seen color and design quite like it? The 10 best dressed men and women in the country look shabby alongside them. If God gives such attention to the wildflowers, most of them never even seen, don't you think he'll attend to you, take pride in you, do his best for you? What I'm trying to get here is to get you to relax, not be so preoccupied with getting, so you can respond to God's giving. People who don't know God and the way he works fuss over these things, but you know both God and how he works. Steep yourself in God reality, God initiative, God provisions. You'll find all your everyday human concerns will be met. Don't be afraid of missing out. You're my dearest friends. The Father wants to give you the very kingdom itself. That's what Jesus said before he said, don't be afraid, little flock, for the kingdom is yours. What a great assurance. It's like the Father is tickled pink. It's his pleasure. He gets great joy that the kingdom is ours. But then this passage that we get today, it takes kind of an odd twist, right? We start off with this warm, comfy assurance of being the little flock, but then we get that, but know this. And so it's like Jesus is saying, yeah, the kingdom is yours, but you got to do something with it. You got to be ready. You got to be dressed. You got to have your lamps lit. You got to be prepared for action. So there's a lot going on in these few verses, and we can struggle to make some sense of all of it. But let's focus on verse 34 today. Let's just zero in on that verse and think about it. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. For the rich man in last week's parable, his treasure was his earthly possessions. Things that rust and fall apart. Things that look like they bring security, but they don't. Things that seem bright and shiny, but they have no eternal value. Jesus told this parable, but this same parable has been retold over and over and over through the ages. Why? Because it's a timeless story. of humanity's struggle to understand what's really important, what really matters, what really has value. In a world that sometimes seems cruel and meaningless. One such story is from the 19th century. A French author, Guy de Maupassant, wrote a story called The Necklace. This story is the story of a young woman named Mathilde, who is a beautiful young woman. But she despises everything about her life. Nothing is good enough. She deserves so much better. Her husband, her clothes, her apartment, everything is trash to her because she thinks she is worth so much more. Well, one day her husband comes home and he's very excited. He's a lowly clerk, but he managed to get an invitation to the grand ball. All the big people will be there. But his excitement is met with her anger. What does he expect her to wear to something like that? And so they dig into their savings and she orders a beautiful gown. And when it arrives, she's still not happy. She has no jewelry. So her husband says, remember that friend you went to school with, the very rich friend? Maybe she'll let you borrow something. So she goes to her friend, and her friend says, of course. So Mathilde rummages through everything she has. Nothing is quite right until she finds a diamond necklace, this huge, brilliant diamond necklace. She goes, this is the one. So she takes it home, she gets dressed, and the night of the ball is absolutely magnificent. She dances with everyone. She is truly the belle of the ball. Until she gets home in the wee hours of the morning and realizes the necklace is gone. Her husband searches everywhere in vain, and they cannot find the necklace. And so they finally decide, we're going to have to replace it. We got to buy another necklace. They go to the jeweler, and they finally find one that looks like it, and it's 36,000 francs. It will take all of the money that her husband's father left him when he died. It will take all of the money they save, and they will still have to go in debt to be able to buy the necklace. But they buy the necklace. Mathilde takes the necklace back to her friend, and what does she get? A reprimand. Rude of you to bring it back after so long. And she just tosses the jewelry bag aside. Mathilde goes back to her life, but it's a different life. Her modest apartment is gone. She and her husband live in an attic room. And Mathilde cooks and cleans and scours and hauls slop all day. And her husband still works as a clerk, but he also works nights and weekends. And finally, 10 long years on, the debt is repaid. But Mathilde is no longer a young and beautiful woman. She's aged beyond her years. Her hands are raw and red. Her dress hangs in tatters. And one day she's walking in the park and she sees her old friend who is still young and beautiful and charming, her old friend who doesn't recognize her at first. And Mathilde thinks, at this point, why not tell her the whole sad story? And so she does. And her friend looks at her. She says, that diamond necklace you borrowed? That was paste. It was a fake. It was a knockoff. It was worth 500 francs. At the most, Mathilde's life, 10 whole years of her life wasted on a necklace of paste. Now, the great 21st century philosopher, Adam Sandler, y'all know Adam Sandler? Oh, yeah, well, you know, I mean, he gives us another cautionary tale of the same kind of thing about laying up treasure in all the wrong places. In a movie called Click, he's given this magical remote control where he can just click through annoying parts of his life. His wife's nagging him, click. You know, his kids are bugging him, click. His raises and his promotions not coming as fast as he wants, click a click to the future. Until he clicks to the end of his days, and he is a wildly successful, extremely rich businessman. But he is a disaster as a human being. Now, you can probably name a few more of these stories right off the top of your head, right? I'm thinking Ebenezer Scrooge, Silas Marner. I mean, these stories continue to be told because we continue to struggle to understand what is really important, what is really valuable, what is real treasure. And we say, does Jesus really want us to give everything away? Because we know money does matter. Ask any parent who needs to buy medication for their child and can't cover the cost of the prescription. Possessions do have value. Ask any musician who takes great joy in her violin or her cello. We're only human, right? We are. Jesus knows that. He knows how easily our hearts are distracted and deceived by the things of this world. And he does not want us to waste our lives on necklaces of paste. So he reminds us, be dressed, be ready. The treasure is all around you. The kingdom of God is yours, and you don't want to miss it. So do not fear, little flock. Fear. Fear is the enemy of faith. Fear tells us all kinds of lies. It locks us into a narrow mindset, a myopic perspective where we only see our own needs, and a ditch of despair where we have no hope. Fear, F-E-A-R, is false evidence appearing real. Fear tells us we're not good enough, we're not rich enough, we're not smart enough, we're not young enough. Fear tells us there isn't enough for everybody else. It's each man and woman for himself and herself. The one who dies with the most toys wins. Fear incites us to live our lives on treasures of paste and forget that all that we have and all that we are is a gift from God. It is given to love and care for our neighbor. Our material gifts, our earthly possessions, those are mere opportunities to share the true treasure of the kingdom and to lay up real treasure in heaven. Because fear is a liar, but faith reveals the truth to us. The truth that our story is so much bigger than this present moment. The truth that our story is eternal and that our earthly journey is only part of it. As Jesus is telling these things to his disciples, he's on a journey to Jerusalem. He's on a journey to the cross. He knows where he's going. So he, as well as we, he knows the journey is hard sometimes. The journey hurts sometimes. It can feel bad. It can look bad. It can even feel hopeless. And that's why it's important in those moments that we remember this. This earth is not our home. The author of Hebrews tells us that clearly in our reading today. We are strangers and foreigners here, seeking a homeland, desiring a better country, a heavenly one, a kingdom that God gives us, a very different kind of kingdom. If you've ever traveled to a foreign country, you know the feeling of culture shock. You just don't quite fit in. That's what it's like to be a follower of Jesus in the world. We don't fit in. We do crazy things. We turn the other cheek. We go the extra mile. We give our life and love away to people who don't deserve it. This is crazy, crazy stuff. Because God's kingdom is a kingdom unlike any other kingdom. When we think kingdom, you know, it's easy to think geographic borders and governments and anthems and flags and all those kind of things of a kingdom. That's not the kind of kingdom that God is giving us. The original word in the Greek is basileia. Basileia. And that word means royal authority, power, dominion. You remember in Genesis, God gives us dominion? That's what he's giving us. Royal authority. We have the Father's kingdom. We can go into the Father's storehouse and get whatever we want, when we want it. And that storehouse is full of the best treasures. It is full of grace and mercy and loving kindness and generosity and peace and love. The storehouse is full, and the Father says, come in, get this stuff, and then go spend it lavishly. Get busy. It's here. Why are you wasting it? So light the lamps. Get dressed. Be alert. Have eyes to see, ears to hear, and hearts to discern where these treasures are needed. Where are those dark places in the world where you need to bring those things? Where instead of an argument, you can bring peace. Instead of hatred and judgment, you bring love and kindness. You have been given the power to distribute these treasures from your Father's abundance. So go ahead, lay up treasure in heaven. That's the other crazy thing about it. The more you spend God's treasure, the more you lay up. It's a crazy different kind of economy. And these are the treasures that are boundless, infinite, eternal. And so we must never let the things of this world be mistaken for treasure. They are merely paste. But don't worry, little flock. The Father has given you the kingdom. The treasure is yours. Do not be afraid. Amen. We're going to sing now, and just that verse is amazing. No storm can shake my inmost calm. So how can we keep from singing? Let's rise and sing now. Confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
trusting in God's extraordinary love, let us come together near to the Holy One in prayer. Let your loving kindness be upon your church. Fill all who proclaim the gospel with your spirit. Equip your flock to speak your word of promise and hope in the midst of fear and uncertainty. Merciful God, hear our prayer. Let your loving kindness be upon your creation. Dwell among us and sustain our earthly home. In places of famine, provide nourishment. In places of plenty, fashion us to be good stewards of your bounty. Merciful God, let your loving kindness be upon your world. Be our helper and our shield in places torn by strife and violence, especially the war in Ukraine and those horrible incidents of violence happening all throughout the United States. Raise up courageous leaders to govern with compassion and justice. Merciful God, let your loving kindness be upon your children. Look upon all who wait for your steadfast love. Console those who grieve and embrace those who cry out to you, especially Jill, Jenny, Bill, Tiffany, Kate, Ken, Jim, Sam, Linda, Erica, Chuck, Tony, Bruce, Susie, Jerry and Pat, Larry and Joyce, Pastor Roger, Joanne, Bud,
Charles, Catherine, Stu, George, Jared, Stacy, Joe, Ron, Kristen, Scott, Susan, Sarah, Carol Lindisman, Mike, Vicky, Hal, Jenny,
merciful God, receive our prayer. Let your loving kindness be upon this community. Fashion our hearts to strive for the way of peace. Strengthen the outreach of the many ministries of this congregation and all who care for those in need. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
With thanksgiving, we remember all who have died in faith and now rest in you. As they place their hope in you, so strengthen us to trust in your promise of new life. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Receive the prayers of your children, merciful God, and hold us forever in your steadfast love. Through Jesus Christ, our holy wisdom.
Let us pray. God of abundance, you have set before us a plentiful harvest. As we feast on your goodness, strengthen us to labor in your field and equip us to bear fruit for the good of all. In the name of Jesus, amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy are yours, God of power, God of might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Join together in praying the prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. The table is now set. Come, feast with the Lord.
Jesus, Lamb.
grant us your peace.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Life-giving God, through this meal you have bandaged our wounds and fed us with your mercy. Now send us forth to live for others, both friend and stranger, that all may come to know your love. This we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. And now receive the benediction of the Lord. May the God of peace, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you, comfort you, and show you the path of life this day and always.
Now go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.